hello everyone. My name is Jakub Namprdalik, and this is a talk about mistakes that I see when people are moving into microservices. I'm not a very interesting person. This is a slide that you can take a screenshot, or basically all the slides are available online. So I'm not going to talk about that, but just in case you wonder. What I do is more interesting, and what I do is I do two things. I work for a company where I'm kind of a consultant, where I do both for like 6 days every month, I do workshops. And I teach teams either the architecture or reactive programming or Spring or test-driven development, behavior-driven development, and or domain-driven design, things like that. On the other 15 days, I help my customers, where I just code with the teams, and when I work with the developers, and we move. Usually, what happens is we move old legacy systems to microservices, and that's a long thing to do, right? So, I travel from company to company, even though I have a major company that that's my biggest client, and I kind of see the things that they struggle with. And it turned out that the things that they struggle with are common, like everybody has got the same problems, and this is the talk about that. So whenever I enter a new company and try to help them in any way, I ask them for an architecture diagram, because I want to learn what the system looks like. Basically, where are we going to put features, right? And usually what happens is I see something like that. They give me a diagram where I can see the Kubernetes clusters that they have with Istio and everything else, a big S data lake, like seriously, this is like the biggest part of the diagram. And a scary Dockerized, usually old core system, whatever you call it. And then you got all the applications around, which are like SAP and Salesforce and so on. Then you got the mobile devices, and you got micro frontends. You got some databases, and that's it. And it's a very interesting diagram, because no matter which company I go to, it's the same diagram. Like, are you building the same system? No. So then I ask them, well, okay, this is a very nice infrastructure diagram. This shows the diagram of your infrastructure, but I would like to learn actually, what does your software do? Like, where do we put features? So they show me something like this in the right corner of the diagram, right? And that's pretty much it. So there's nothing I can learn from that apart from that they use the usual things. But the diagram is good, but it's infrastructure only, right? And it's the same infrastructure everybody else has, so it's not interesting. Now, when I ask them about, give me the diagram of those microservices that you actually have, how do they communicate, what do they talk with, right? Then there's a problem, because usually I don't get anything, and if I don't get anything, at least I can get like a diagram of the organization chart, something like that. So if I'm lucky, they give me something like this, where I can see that they have some teams, and those teams are responsible for some like orders and catalog and basket and everything else. So maybe based on that, I can talk with those teams. This diagram is not very good because you can see here there's an event bus there, and you don't know what messages those teams sent, basically. So every organization has got a team chart, or basically a responsibility chart, which team is responsible for what, because that's what the management wants. But still, this is not what I would like to have when I want to understand your architecture. So then I go to different teams and to people from those teams, and I ask them, can you draw the diagram for me? Can you tell me how the system works? And they do. They draw the beautiful diagrams, and each team has got a diagram which is in opposition to other teams. So basically, this is like contradictory diagrams, right? They can't work together. It's not possible that the system works this way. And this is very unfortunate, because one of the definitions of architecture is actually the shared understanding of the people in the project. And then I see there is no shared understanding at all. And I ask the developers, not like the senior developers, just the normal developers in those teams, like, where do you put your feature, your shiny new feature that you just worked on? And they say to me, like, well, it depends what I'm working right now on, like in which microservice I have like opened in my IntelliJ, or they answer things like, well, it's totally random. And both answers are not exactly the answers that I was looking for. So the question is, how did that happen? Why did I have a very good infrastructure diagram and no diagrams of the actual infrastructure of the architecture of the microservices? And it's usually because of who draws those diagrams, right? So the infrastructure diagram is easy to draw because these are usually the people that used to be responsible for the infrastructure on-premise. And this is usually a small team. Like if you have 200 developers, you can still have 10 people who are responsible for the infrastructure on-premise for those 200 developers. And so the team is like a single team. They got a king or a queen, and they can just draw this to get shit done, right? And they, well, it can be contradictory if it's inside the team, so it's good. But then the question is, where does the diagram should come from for the microservices? And here I see like three different patterns. The first pattern is that the companies who want to move to microservices and public or private cloud actually do not have anyone who can draw those diagrams. Like, we have a bunch of very good developers, but the management doesn't trust them enough. And so they say, we need to hire somebody new, somebody who knows how to move to microservices. And they usually hire enterprise architects for that. And the reason for it is that, well, see the definition. A well-defined practice of conducting enterprise analysis, design, planning, and implementation using a comprehensive approach at all times for the successful development and execution of strategy. Yes, that's what CTO thinks. Yeah, we need exactly that person. That person is going to solve all our problems, right? So from the perspective of the developers, this looks like not exactly the thing I would like to see, right? So, and so the enterprise architect usually is hired for that job. And the interesting thing is that, well, enterprise architect is responsible for the enterprise, for the architecture of the enterprise, not exactly of the architecture of the software system. In fact, Simon Brown, author of the book Architecture for Developers, says that the only thing that they don't do is they don't do software system design, right? So what, and you can kind of see that whenever you see the diagrams and enterprise architect get you, and I've seen a lot of them, they usually look something like that. No arrows. What's a diagram that has no arrows? Basically, just a list of lists. That's it, right? Or if there are arrows, they are like big arrows with no information on them, and you still can't do anything with that. And I thought that maybe I just have a bad experience with enterprise architects, and maybe I'm just unlucky to meet the bad ones. But it turns out that I meet the bad ones because the good ones do not do the software architecture at all. They are not responsible for it, right? The problem with the description of the job is that it's so wide that the CTO doesn't know that this is a person that can help you, but this is not a person that can draw diagrams or basically create your architecture that you're going to have on microservices and in cloud. So they don't know that. They push the job to that person, and that person, because that person earns a lot of money, thinks like, okay, I need to do this. I have no idea how to do it. Okay, let's draw some boxes. And you get a bunch of boxes that make no sense. So this is the scenario that usually happens when I get the diagrams from the enterprise architects about the architecture of the system, right? And it's so common, there is a, like, this is a running joke, right? This is not only my perspective. This is like somebody even wrote a comic on that. So what happens from this is either the enterprise architects get completely ignored because developers think like, you know, they don't know what they're doing, or in worst case scenario, the developers start to play the game. So they are like, okay, we're going to implement those boxes. They don't have to talk with each other, so it's very easy to implement them, right? They don't even have to do any work. That's a great thing. Or the most popular version is like, okay, we have some kind of a responsibility, but basically that people do not know what they are doing, so maybe we can play like a blame game. We're going to build something anyway, and then they're going to blame us for that we didn't deliver on time, and we're going to blame them for delivering shitty diagrams and things like that. So it's a tough situation, okay? So enterprise architects are not good for this, okay? They are good for different things, not for that. So the other option that the companies usually have is when there was already a lead architect, or maybe a few, and that lead architect was good and recognized as, you know, this is the good person, like he really leads other people and can communicate well and knows something about architecture. Let's have, and you could have like a single system with 200 developers on it and still have a single architect for that. And the magic that makes it work is actually ArchUnit. Basically, any library that can verify and check the architecture for you and make sure that it still stays the same, even though there are 200 people working on developing on that, right? So this is possible with a monolithic application. Not so much when you have microservices. Then your lead architect dies because it used to be one repository. Now you have 50 people. Let's say that only 250 people work there as a developers, which means you got 10 teams, which means you got about 40 Git repositories, assuming you have one team taking care of four microservices, something like that, which is okay for a year. After 3 years, it's more like 14, maybe. So people need to make decisions on the fly, and whatever you designed for at the very beginning in terms of the architecture is not going to stay because they are going to break it. So what happens, and the lead architect does not know when it breaks because it's not a single repository, and you most likely will not start your everyday of starting with like pulling from 40 different repositories and checking every single pull request. No way to do that, right? So basically, this does not scale. Doesn't work at all. So what's the other option? And then there is this option, which is kind of getting more and more popular, which is to create some kind of an architectural guild, sometimes called architectural tribe. Anybody has got a tribe or a guild? Yeah, like one-third of the room, not bad. So sometimes those architecture guilds are very good and they look very professional, like really fat, rich people, right? They know what they're doing. And it's great, but this talk is not about that situation. This talk is about when this guild doesn't look so well. It looks like some people playing games, you know? Like, you know, the average age of a developer in IT around here is probably about, I don't know, 32, 28. So you got this guild of 28 people, 28-year-old people that have no suits and basically don't look very good, right? And what happens next? Well, if this is a dysfunctional guild, you can tell by this. First of all, you will see that they have private communication channels. So like, okay, they have a Slack channel or maybe Teams channel or whatever else where they communicate. Nobody can access that. Then they see they have no outcomes. So basically the management says like, okay, we want to have those guilds because they work. Everybody says they work. And you got those guilds. But then it turns out, I don't know what the guild produces. Was the outcome of the guild, and the management kind of loses trust. They have no practices. Even the guild themselves do not know what they are doing in terms of like what's the process. No, the process is a bad word in development. Let's just do some coding. Well, that's very unfortunate because the architecture guild doesn't do much coding at all. And then you got no responsibility, and nothing is published. So what happens next? Well, the management, because they see no outcome, they say that they lose trust in the guild, and they hire an enterprise architect again, and they disband the guild. And it makes sense for them, right? And we are back to the square one. So I know a few cases where it actually happened, that the company had an architectural guild for 3 months, maybe 4 months, or maybe half a year, and it got disbanded, right? And back to their enterprise architect. So the question is how to do it well. Well, actually, there is some documentation for that. This is a beautiful article about having an architectural guild for 800 people. So it's not that small. And there are a lot of practices. But you can read that article, so I'm not going to talk about that. Instead, what I'm going to talk is I'm going to talk about power plants, nuclear power plants. Actually, my experience with a team that I'm helping, or with the company that I'm helping, and where we actually build that architecture guild. And we build it for a company which has got power plants, right? Not great, not terrible, right? So please appreciate how the designer nuclear power plants has got this course or whatever it's called. But see how the designer of the building actually designed this as kind of a message to climate deniers. Right? You see this? Wonderful. Yeah. So, because of course, nuclear power plants are very, maybe not that safe, but, well, they are actually safe, but most of all, they don't produce anything bad, so that they influence the climate. So let's move on. Everything I'll tell you now is from the real experience there. And the thing, the first thing I saw was like, okay, we got the guild. The management says, we want you to have the guild. So we started to have a guild. But the guild didn't do any much. In terms of actually, we were meeting every single sprint, and we were trying to solve issues, but we were not informing anyone about anything. So I said, okay, in 3 months' time, we are most likely going to be disbanded or something like that. Let's change it. First suggestion is this. Let's actually be responsible, which means that, first of all, let's create a Git repository where we will put all the information about the guild and like put all the things that we do inside this repository, which makes sense because the guild is usually built from a bunch of developers, so they know Git very well, right? And then we do this. We need to decide what the guild does and what it doesn't, and we need to write it down. So actually, there is a repository. So we put a README file in Markdown for the repository, and we wrote down all the things describing how we work, when we want to achieve, what are we responsible for, and don't call us if this happens, right? So we decided that the guild is responsible for knowledge sharing, which means that we need to draw the diagram because nobody else could. So we need to this kind of a diagram, and we need to keep it updated. Then we need the common practices because, well, microservices require a lot of good practices, and basically a lot of problems in terms of the infrastructure and so on are going to happen. And you need to take that into account whenever you are designing architecture. Then we will do the technical research and recommendations because, you know, there are teams and there are product owners. And so in some teams, the product owners are like these people with like, and you have no time to actually do any research, but you have to actually deliver, right? Business value. And so we will do that. We will protect that time for the people in those teams so they can do the research that is necessary. And then we will do a proactive architecture changes. So we won't wait till we need to move somewhere. We will actually, seeing where the business goes and cooperating with the business, we will actually prepare ourselves for the future. And then we will solve the urgent issues because there are always urgent issues, right? Then we decided we want to be responsive. And being responsive, you know, if you have a guild that meets every sprint or every 2 weeks, then whenever there is a question from management or maybe someone else, it waits there for 2 weeks before they actually is being picked up and somebody answers, right? This is no good. So we decided that we are going to have like a speaker of the guild. Think about the speaker of the house in the UK Parliament. Maybe you know the guy who says, order, order, right? Maybe you don't. But anyway, he's a cool guy. So we decided to have something like that. And this is going to be a rotating role because there is not a single leader inside the guild. So let's keep it this way. And we're going to ensure that that person will be responsible for answering all the questions from the outside. Calling for a working group whenever there is an issue which is urgent, which needs to be resolved right away. That person will be accountable for processes and outcomes. So basically, when there is a not interesting problem, people usually tend to ignore it as long as they can. That person will push and kick until it gets solved, right? So this is the kind of a responsivity that we need. Then it is going to be a nice human interface of the guild. Maybe not that nice because it turned out that most of us are developers and, well, you know, you can't do much with that, but we'll try. And then you have to be inclusive, which means that we started to invite everyone to the guild. Like before that, this was a closed group. And now it's like, okay, you want to join us? Let's do it. And I'm going to approve you by default, like you're already in there, right? And this repository that I told you about, we gave everyone access to, right? The whole company. Like you want to see it, you want to make a pull request, do it. Don't worry, right? And this makes sure that we are not kind of like trying to, you know, think from only one perspective. And I'll give you an example. It turned out that most of the people in the architecture guild were some kind of backend developers. And a lot of our decisions are driven by the frontend. So we actually said, okay, we can't do it like this. We need those frontend guys here. And they said like, well, when we thought about architecture, we thought that this is going to be the backend architecture. No, this is the architecture for the whole system of the whole company. All the microservices, the micro frontends, everything else. And they joined, right? So this is kind of a reaching out to people, getting them in, right? And then we need to be efficient because otherwise, what's the guild for? So the guild meets every sprint, and goes through the action points and non-urgent issues that you know get to the agenda. But when there is an urgent issue, the speaker of the guild actually calls a meeting right away, and whoever is there at work basically joins from the guild and tries to solve the problem. So whenever there is a problem, what do? We create a work group, like a small group of people that are going to work on that problem. There is no point in having 15 people working on a problem. No problem was ever solved by a group of 15 people, right? You need 4 maximum. If you ever played role-playing games, you need 5, right? But other than that, you need 4. And that's it. Otherwise, you are not efficient in communication. So then the work group starts to do the research. And they actually need to do the research. You need to read white papers. You need to read books. You need to reach out to other companies. You need to do proof of concepts. And after you got that, then you publish a request for comment, which is just a document in Markdown inside the same repository that the guilded repository, right? And you send the message to everyone like, okay, this is a new request for comments, please do comment. And then you give them a week because sometimes people are on vacation or, for example, on a conference. So you give them some time when they can actually show their feedback for this, and you will be surprised how often people who were not interested at the very beginning of the process on this issue have a very interesting perspective or something interesting to say about the problem later on when the request for comment is being published. And whenever we achieve a consensus, basically we know that this is at the moment something we will all go for, then we publish a thing called architecture decision record, or basically a recommendation. Recommendation meaning what everyone else should do with this. So the RFCs and architecture decision records are just ways of storing both the information at the very beginning of making a decision and at the end of the making the decision, so that, for example, you know that somebody actually thought about pros and cons of the options. Somebody actually consider the different options. You would be surprised, and I was definitely surprised when most of the engineers, whenever they make architectural decision, they are like, you know what, I've heard on the last conference about this, let's use it. Is it the best for this tool? I don't know, let's just use it. Yeah, good. Okay. Or maybe they think about, I've used that in the past, so I'm going to use it again. Are there any better tools right now? Who cares? Let's just go, right? So this makes it so that you actually have to write it down, so you have to actually think about those things and then consequences. Consequences are very interesting. There's a lot of good intentions and good decisions that have very negative consequences. So you have to kind of think about it and see how it's going to break and how people are going to abuse this, right? And then you publish the architecture decision record, which is basically very, very similar. So right now what we do is we just take the RFC and we just mark it as published and move it to the architecture decision record directory inside the repository, so it's simple. And you got it. There are several layouts there. There's a link here, right? Who else works like that? Well, it turns out there is quite a lot of companies or organizations that actually develop this way, where they publish something and they ask you for all the input that you can get, and it's open, it's transparent, and then you get that input, and then they start to actually produce that, so they can see that the things that they had in mind at the very beginning are completely wrong. So this means that we need to be transparent. And to be transparent, what we did was, first of all, we created a Slack channel. We are actually using MS Teams, but it works exactly the same way, where you can ask and talk with the guild, and the speaker of the guild is always on duty there. So actually, you will have a response very, very fast. So that's important. Then we created a broadcast email, of course, so that we all get an email, so there is a single email address where you can contact the guild. And then we published the newsletter. And it sounds like, really, guys? You are publishing newsletters now? Yeah, and that's because we need to tell the management and everyone else what we were doing. And we write about what we did, what we are working on, what are the RFCs, and how to contact the guild, and who's the speaker of the guild, so who's responsible right now. And it helps a lot communicating with, because we don't send this to the IT department, they already know that. We send it to everyone, to the whole business unit, right? So they know exactly what to do whenever they have a question and whenever there is some new discussion out there, right? And the interesting thing here is that at the very beginning, people thought that the architecture guild is going to make decisions. Like, we are going to like decide on things and be important. No, we're not. We are going to only make recommendations. Why is that possible? Why so? And the thing is that whenever you have a large company and a lot of microservices and a lot of teams, there is no way you're going to be in the shoes of the people that are actually living there and seeing the consequences of these decisions. And if you want to see what happens when people make decisions for other people and see no consequences of that, you can look at the politics. I don't know how the politics for this country looks like, but you can look at the Polish politics. It's really shitty. So basically, what that means is every person can make a stupid decision if they do not need to live with the consequences, right? So we're not going to make decisions. We are going to make recommendations. And if you want to break that recommendation, that's okay. But you're going to now have live with the consequences of your decision, right? And you would be amazed how strong the peer pressure is. Like, we didn't have a single case when somebody would break the recommendation. Everybody would be like, okay, I'm going to work on this. And okay, maybe I don't agree exactly, but okay, we have agreed to do this way, so let's do it, right? And it turns out that doesn't happen too often, right? Or at all right now. And then you have to think about it that just because I want to be in an architectural guild doesn't mean that I have the necessary knowledge and vocabulary to basically be able to talk about architecture. And it turns out that, well, there is a book, and there is a lot of books, but this I like the most because it's very boring. It's very boring because, like, you will read that book and you think, okay, I know that. Like, there's nothing new. Well, why am I even on the page 100? And then you will see, that's a new thing. Oh, I should have known that before, but now I do. So okay, so this is like a book that levels up this is a very basic book, but it levels up the knowledge for all the developers so they can work together on the architecture, right? So we need to do that. And the next thing we need to do is we need to talk about what are we optimizing our architecture for? Because you can't get everything. Like, we want to have the scalable, performant, secure architecture, and it should cost us nothing, right? No way to do it. So actually, what you have to think about is what are the most important parts. And most of the developers actually make a wrong decision there. When I talk with developers and I teach architecture, so actually I see a lot of teams there, they say, the performance is probably most important, right? Or sometimes they say, well, I need this service to be available or the whole system to be available. So basically, this is the most important part. For most of the companies, what actually is the most important is this. It is to be able to spend the least amount of time supporting the system that you've built. Because when you have a team and it spends 30 or 40% of the time resolving tickets of an old system or some other microservices, it's no good for you delivering new features. So basically, when you don't know what to do, choose this part. And when you do know what to do, then you can have to decide on this and put it in paper so that everybody else knows that you are optimizing, for example, for time to market, right? If I'm optimizing for time to market, then I can break things, okay? So don't worry about breaking things. Unless, of course, there is a nuclear power plant involved. Then you have to think about the constraints. Like, a lot of people are really passionate about, in development, are really passionate about technologies, but you have to think about time and budget and people. If you want to go in Scala, for example, it's great unless you're living in Croatia where there are no Scala developers whatsoever, or that's what I was told years ago. So basically, you have to think about all those things. The next thing is, of course, we have to produce diagrams. And diagrams are like maps. And I'm not going to talk a lot about it. We decided to use the C4 model because it's very, very simple, and actually it works. So you can like be the master of the C4 in 15 minutes, which is great. And because all those diagrams and models are kept as code in the repository. And this is very important for us because don't make a picture of that. This is not the nuclear power plant architecture. This is just like a sample. Okay, so whenever you need this, when you have the architecture diagrams inside the code, what happens is that it's very easy for developers to change. And the whole idea is that this is not going to be changed by architects, this is going to be changed by everyone, because, well, you'll just make a Git pull and then change the code and produce a new diagram. So that works for us. And then you need to teach people how to validate those diagrams, because you can actually do quite a lot of validation and verifying of the architecture without actually implementing anything, just on a diagram. And what usually happens is that when I ask people to explain the diagram to other teams, and they go with their finger on the diagram, and they follow the usual use cases, they find a lot of problems. So instead of doing this with a finger, how about using a sequence diagram that, you can put in your code, because, for example, web sequence diagrams have got a representation of the sequence diagram in the code, so that whenever somebody is making changes, they'll be able to see right away how does it influences all the other use cases. And this is important, because then you can, like, manually, using your deep learning mind and AI inside of your head, actually verify whether the diagram is good or not without actually implementing anything. Yeah, something's wrong with the mic. Okay, so thank you. So when we started to, actually do this, and as I said, the enterprise architects are supposed to be taking care of the enterprise, like the organization, right? And the software architects and the software architectural guild is more like about software architecture. Well, not true. To be honest, the software architectural guild has got to take care about all the architecture inside the, both the enterprise and the software architecture, because they are interconnected, basically, with business needs, with how teams are set up, and so on. And I'll give you an example, because the CTO of the company basically decided one day that that we are going to have cross-cutting teams. And cross-cutting teams for them means that every single team will be able to implement any single feature inside any single code base, which sounds like a very good idea, except not. And the feedback from all the developers was like, no, 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 don't do that. This will break. This will be horrible. There'll be no quality whatsoever. Okay, but actually, this is the idea from the CTO. So how about doing some research on this? And it turns out that there is already research there that the architectural guild can provide and can, like, check, right? So there was a research based, and it's from Microsoft, and it's based on and it's verified on different Microsoft systems. And if you have ever been using Windows, you know that every second version is shitty, right? And every, like, the second version is okay, and then there is a shitty one, there is okay one. So they stopped at 10, which was brilliant. And this research was actually like, let's see if just by looking at how the teams and the organization is set up, we can actually predict how many errors, bugs, and issues are going to be there on production. And it turned out that, well, their model for that is correct. They actually successfully verified that Windows Vista is going to be shitty without implementing Windows Vista, of course, 10 years after Windows Vista was deployed, right? So it's a very interesting research. And this research says things like this. The greater the number of engineers that touch the code, the higher the failure rate. So no, you don't want to have a lot of developers touching the single code base. The more edits to a component, the higher the instability and thus failure rate, right? So if you want to have a microservice which is stable, don't touch it. Very simple. Now, components that were owned by master, a single person with 75% or more of edits, had lower failure rates, right? Like, you can't be contradicting yourself a lot inside your code. And then the lower the overall percentage of the organization that contributed to development, the lower the failure rate, right? Does it sound like silos, right? In the old days. The more code, and so on, so on. So we found all this research, and we provided that to the management and told them, you know what? Here's the thing. Here are the rules. Each code base can be changed by only one team, and that's it. One team can have several code bases, but once it has a code base, nobody else can touch that, right? You can make a pull request. We're not going to approve that, that's for sure, because you put white spaces somewhere where we don't like it, and you're destroying our feng shui or whatever else, but that doesn't matter. Then the cross-cutting concerns that we have, and we do have cross-cutting concerns, the monitoring, sometimes the front end, the DBs, right? They require a separate guild to work on the best practices and solving problems, like with Kubernetes. There's a lot of problems with Kubernetes that needs to be solved. So we got a new guild for Kubernetes. Then the teams should communicate as little as possible, because we don't like having meetings, right? It stops us from actually delivering anything. And then teams should coordinate as little as possible. But we got those guys who are called product owners. And they should communicate as much as possible because they are good only for talking, right? So actually it's perfect. It fits everyone's needs, right? And the management actually liked that a lot. So they said, oh, yeah, that's a good thing, right? And then we went even further when we said, okay, based on the next research that we did, what happens is this, that, well, you should most likely create your structure of the organization based on the architecture that we provide, on the microservices that we want to build. That would be the best, like have the same products and the same teams responsible for products, no cross-cutting concerns, or maybe no like matrix organization or something like that. It would be better. Then we decided, okay, and all the teams should communicate by an event bus, because then you will have actually dropped the temporal coupling, so I don't have to think about whether your service actually is alive or not. Then we will introduce consumer-driven contracts, because otherwise we don't know whether we can talk with each other before we go to production. And yeah, we proposed the whole setup for the teams based on the architecture diagrams that we had, and management like that, so it works. But, you know, there's a little problem there inside, well, especially for Europe. There is, except for the UK, but it's not Europe anymore, so it doesn't matter. There are like two different cultures of management in Europe. And one of them, and this is actually from Simon Brown, but I've observed the same situation. One of them comes from the north, where we have the power plant that I've shown you, because it was in Sweden, where there's a culture of empowerment and trust, and it's great. And there is a culture from the UK, which is about command and control, which is not so great for developers. But actually, I think that if you have a power plant, you should have some maybe control at least, right? So what happens when you move into microservices in a situation like this, the command and control kind of management style is always a problem, right? And you can see this when you see people who have titles like deployment manager. Who has seen a deployment manager? Some of you have. So what happens is I was always curious, what's the job of a deployment manager? This is usually a person that is not technical enough, right, to make any decisions. They don't code, they don't make decisions, they just stood there, right? But this is what they're for. They have suits, and they look good. They are middle-aged, usually men, with a title of the manager, right? And what they do is, whenever there's something bad on production, and you have a CTO there, which is being fired at from the stakeholders, he can fire the deployment manager, right? And blame him for that. And that's what they do. And they are perfect for it. They don't have to do anything else, right? So it's wonderful, except I didn't know that at the very beginning, but now I do. So this is the kind of a control for deployments. And when you have a monolithic application, a deployment is a big thing. Like I've seen a lot of companies where there's like an email saying, today we deploy. And they say, but there are still breaking tests, so please work on them. And they say, okay, but there are still behavioral threats that are breaking, so please work on those. And then when we failed to deploy, tomorrow we'll try again. And those emails, I even get invitation to the calendar for the event of deployment, the blessed event of deployment. Okay, so when those companies move to microservices, what they have to understand is each microservice is individually deployable, so you don't have to talk with anyone. And this doesn't work with deployment managers, right? And this is scary for the management, until you actually explain to them that you had a lot of problems with the deployment because they were big deployments with a lot of risk. Now, when we want to change the CSS of one single microservice, then no more changes from the master are going to get there except for the CSS, so it's not going to break, except that it's going to look ugly. So people understand that, and then you have to learn and use the things like rolling deployments, A/B testing, automatic rollbacks, and so on, and they get okay with it. But that's a problem at the very beginning all the time. And with the deployment, there is another problem, which is the QAs. I work with the QAs, and they are wonderful people. I love them. But at the very beginning, they are always scared. They are scared shitless when we are moving to microservices. And the reason why they are scared is that I explain to them they can't do end-to-end testing anymore. And they're like, what? No way, dude. And you can see that on every organization that has got like several different environments before things go to production. Like if a new organization with a monolithic application goes to microservices, they have like dev, test, stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, starting, no production. The most I've seen was actually seven different layers, seven different environments that the pipeline was pushing the code for. I don't know why. And whenever you see an organization that has got a lot of experience in microservices, they have just two environments. They have development environment, nobody knows how it works. And then you got production, right? And that's the only one which is important. The development environment is sometimes used for like things like demo, or maybe for like, I'm going to test whether this deployment screen like, actually works, whether the Helm charts are OK or not, and that's it, right? So basically, that's what happens later on, because you move to testing on production. And you cannot do testing on the test environment, because you never can set up the test environment the way it works in production. And why? Even if you only had three different services, managed by three different teams, A, B, and C, and one of them wanted to move to version 2, then the only sane way to actually test end-to-end would be to test all the possible combination of all the services that can actually move to another version as well at that time, because by the end of your integration tests, the situation on the production can be completely different. And that happens even if your tests only take like 10 minutes, which is not bad for most organizations, right? So QAs are scared shitless. But then they learn that they are still needed, because they are scared shitless usually because they think that they're going to lose the job. No, you're not going to lose your job. You're not going away this easy, right? First of all, they start helping developers write better tests, because developers are usually quite shitty at writing like, requirements, writing down requirements, creating behavioral specifications. So they help the developers do that. Then there is the consumer-driven contracts, which need to be introduced, because otherwise we will only know that things break on production, not before. Then there's this whole setup of monitoring, and developers are not very great at monitoring, because when they were on the monolithic application, they didn't have to do shit. They just had operation guys providing them with logs and everything else. And then there's chaos engineering, which is the best part, which is like, okay, it's so stable right now that I'm going to destroy something just to still have my job. And it's great, because the only way to actually prove that things are working is by trying to destroy it. So QAs are changing us as hell with this. And then, so, with developers who need to learn how to monitor things, need to understand how to set up the business metrics on monitoring, for example, and then need to actually understand how to debug and things and fix them on production, because you don't have the test environment anymore, right? So you're going to fix things as they go. And developers are usually not ready for that as well. And I'm not talking about people who have Windows, because the company required them to have Windows, so they don't know how to use shell on Linux servers that they're using at work. I'm talking about things like the low-level things, like just Adam Dubilt said on the previous talk. So with that comes another problem, which is the security guys. And the security people, when we are moving from a monolithic system to microservices, they try to use the same books that they used to have for like the last 30 years, and it's not really working. And because in those books, what they had is like, you have to stop people from using anything. Like, you can't install software on your computer, because those books are usually for the IT, for the security people of not like the IT departments. Not for developers, but for security of the business people, right? So you stop allowing them install anything and doing anything except work, and they'll do only work, plus the porn sites, maybe. But that's it, right? So it doesn't work for developers. Why it doesn't work for developers? Because, well, we write code. So whenever the security thinks about this, like, yeah, how do we check whether the code that they write is not something malicious? Oh, we can't. We don't know how to write code, and we don't know how to understand this, so we're going to ignore that problem. And so I've seen a lot of companies where you get laptop with no root access, okay, and you still have to support somehow the production, but they do not check anything about how you deploy things to production and what code you provide there, right? So this is like the Smurfs here, and the kind of like, you can see that they can move through, right? But it still prohibits them from moving, because it's only annoying, and that's it. So can we do anything better about security when we are using microservices? And it turns out we can. And I want to share with you how much we hate stupid security rules. Like, anybody working in a company where you have some sites like GitHub or Stack Overflow which you can't access? Oh, yeah. So do you have phones? You do. You have mobile plans. So do you have access? You do, of course. Everybody does that. So that's a joke, not a security, right? Then we have blessed dependencies. There are companies, and I'm talking about on examples of banks usually, that are like, okay, we can only use those libraries here which are blessed. And those libraries are usually outdated like a lot. And they have security holes in them the size of the planet, right? And you should upgrade them, but you can't because this is not a blessed version because somebody has got to bless it. So then what you do? Well, you do this. You basically unpack the library and do repack it and under your own name, and it's all you need, right? And you got all the classes and everything is done. And then I see companies, and this is the best story, when that company that, and this was of course a bank, that when they said that you can't use other languages than Java. And the guys working there were quite smart, and they said, well, we're going to use Scala anyway. So what are we going to do? Well, they check the class path. They check everything on the class path and all the jars. So how about we are going to put iLibraries, jars, and everything, and zip them and put them in PNG files, graphical files, because they don't check that. And then we're going to write a bootstrap application which will actually start the class loader and load all those classes and actually allow us to work in Scala. And they did it. So, you know, like security, yeah, sure, secure my ass. So don't make it hard. Don't make it hard for people to do their work because we will hack you. Basically, what it means is if you run my code on your server, this is my server now. I'm the captain now, right? Because we all know the holes in the especially in the Intel processors, so that it's as good as you can have no security at all. Can we do something better than that? Because I can't go to the security department and tell them, you know what, you're doing a shitty job, you got wrong books, and there's no solution for that. That won't help. So what can I do? Well, there's another thing we can do. Since we have several microservices, and each team has got several microservices, and they need to have access to all the tools and the whole stack, because otherwise it's going to be hell difficult to debug, how about giving them their own Kubernetes cluster? And since all the Kubernetes clusters are going to communicate between teams as through the message bus, the only thing that they can do for other people is send them a message or receive their message, if we allow for that. And then give them all the access, so they have the kubectl, the root, everything they need, actually, and make them responsible for the environment, for the whole cluster. It's actually the definition of DevOps, developer operating their system on production, right? So if we did something like this, then what would happen is that if we have some bad actor there, they can break some parts of the system, but only that part which they would be able to break anyway because their code is running on those servers, right? And now they won't. So it also helps because, for example, it allows you to do billing better. I'm using Azure, and for each cluster, we can set up each cluster inside of the Azure resource group, and so you can limit the developers. So for example, the company will not go out of business just because you are still running stress tests on tests or production system after a year because you forgot to turn it off, but actually you will, as a team, you will run out of money, and this is going to impact your SLA, but not the SLA of everyone else, right? So it actually gives a lot of benefits there. And to understand all of that, you have to understand the event-based architecture. And a lot of people have a problem with that. And if I could recommend one book about event-driven architecture, that will be that book, okay? And I know this is for free, by the way. You can download it. It is based on Apache Kafka, but actually it describes the kind of patterns that you can use even if you use Rabbit or whatever else, right? Because you're going to need those read models anyway. So if you don't have Apache Kafka, you're going to feed them yourself. So this is kind of a book that will change the perspective, and whenever you're moving to microservices, I think this is the book you should read as the first one, right? Okay, and then there we have the last problem, which is the people who think that when something is provided as a service, then it means it's safe, it works, it's got good SLA. And we found out the hard way. Because we were starting to use services from the provider, for us that was Microsoft, we started to use a thing called CosmoDB. And CosmoDB, well, started to break after 50 inserts per second to the database. Like 50 inserts per second, like I can't do more. I can't do 500 inserts. Like, what happens? Why? Right? There must be something wrong with what I'm doing where, you know, Commodore 64 could make 50 inserts per second. Come on, right? So I contacted the Microsoft support, and they told me, next day, okay, we got your message. And it turns out that, yeah, you have this problem in production. We can confirm this is a problem on our side, and we're going to fix this. We are working on it. Stay tuned. So I was okay. Next day, they said, we're still working on it. Stay tuned. So I was like, okay, 2 days are off on the production. Not so great, but not terrible, right? Okay, so a week later, they asked me, what version of .NET are you using? And I said, guys, with the first issue that I reported, I actually gave you a repository in Git with Java, because I'm using Java, that is making this problem visible, because there's a software there. If you run it, it breaks at 500 inserts per second. And maybe it's my fault. Maybe I'm doing something wrong. Just tell me what, okay? Okay, so they say, okay, 1 week later, all right, we're on it. A month later, well, I decided already that we're going to screw this database and just switch to another one. So we did. But a month later, they asked me again if I see this problem again happening, right? So I ran the application that I had on the first day. And yeah, it still was breaking. So I said, yes, it was. It was still happening. So they asked, which version of .NET are you using? I said, okay, guys, I give up. I'm not going to use the database anymore. I'm going to recommend everyone else not to use it. I'm leaving, right? A month later, I got another mail saying that if I'm still seeing that problem, and what version of .NET am I using? So it's like, come on. So what happens is, what's the lesson? The lesson is very, very simple. Every large company, Microsoft, Google, Amazon, everyone, right? Every large company has got good teams and bad teams. And sometimes those bad teams create products. And sometimes those products should never see the light of day. But they also, those companies also have marketing departments, and they are good marketing departments, and they can sell everything. And then you stay with CosmoDB as a service, for example. I called the other guys from other companies to see if they see the same problem. They said, okay, we had exactly the same situation. We moved back. We don't use that anymore. And they said that they called the guys from the Microsoft, the internal guys, you know, the guys we were drinking beer with, just to ask about that. And they said, like, don't use it. So, yeah. Okay. The lesson from this is, it's wonderful that there's software as a service. You can have a database, you can have a message bus, you can have everything else. Read the SLA. If you see, and again, an example from Microsoft. Sorry, Microsoft. You make wonderful keyboards. I'm sorry. But, so I'm not bashing the company. Apache Kafka, okay? You can get Apache Kafka by Microsoft on their cloud, supported by them, right? And you think, okay, the SLA is great. What's the SLA? Like 99.79. It's wonderful, right? Wonderful. And then you read the documents, the details. And the details say, you got those 7.9s for the machine that the Apache Kafka runs on, and you have no route to that machine. And then when the service breaks, the Kafka actually breaks, what's the SLA for that? There is none. And it's not a problem, because this service is actually supposed to be used for big data. So it's like it's a batch processing. It's a stream processing later on. So it's not live processing, so you don't care. So basically, the customers usually say, OK. But you have to read those small things. Otherwise, you're going to start using something, and you're going to think, yeah, it's Microsoft. They make wonderful keyboards. They have to have a good database. And no, I'm sorry, that's not that simple, right? So beware of that. So my time is up. And after 1 year of having an architectural guild inside the company that is my client, which got the wonderful nuclear power plants, I think we managed to earn the trust of the management, because they said, okay, you know what? This is so good. We are so happy that you have this approach, that we actually are going to give you ask you to prepare the IT strategy for the next year, which is like a document that you, like, you know, this is the direction that we are going, this is the things that we are going to change in terms of the whole corporation, and because, well, we need money, and somebody who is going to give us money, and I mean departments inside the company, needs to read what we are going to do. So we created this 28 pages, font size 8, with 27 contributors, right? And this is the document that usually was created by one single enterprise architect. And you can, if you compare their 99 PowerPoint slides to our 28 pages, it's much better. And then it's updated by everyone. And I even can show you that it's updated by everyone because see the date of the last updates. See, this is 2 days ago, right? So it's not really bad. And then all the devs actually understand it and they say have something to say about it and they agree to that. So it's like a shared knowledge, shared understanding of what we are building, how we are building this, and the decisions that we make. And it seems that it works, unless it breaks. And I'll give you another talk next year if it breaks. Thank you very much. Now, there is the Slido, and there is one question here. What type of culture is typical for Central Europe? For Central Europe, and my experience in base is based on like Poland, Latvia, Lithuania, maybe a little bit of Estonia, and so on, so on. I think that it's mixed, and it's mixed really bad. Sometimes it's the empowerment and trust, other times it's command and control. I see companies in Poland, for example, that have enterprise, they have architects in Germany that make all the decisions for them. Yeah, you know how it works, right? So I've seen companies in Poland having architects in the US, and that's the best one because there's like 7 or 8 hours difference, right? So it's like, hello, Houston, are you there? We lost contact with you, but we managed to actually deliver the system in the meantime. So yeah, there's like more space to actually do something about it. So I don't know which is more popular, but I know that both present here. And I think that whenever you're choosing a company, you should actually look at what they do and talk with the guys to see what the management uses. Okay, so I'm working on software that is charging electric cars, okay? So they have the power plant because they need the power, right? But I'm working on software which actually, if you have a Tesla or any kind of electric car, and you drive there and you charge it and it doesn't work, then you can blame me, okay? Other than that, I'm not touching the power plant. Because, you know, the Java for many years had actually this like a note in the license agreement that it's not supposed to be used on power plants on anything nuclear, right? But like they removed that, so actually it's okay now. Okay, no more questions. Thank you very much.